Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Good to see everybody here. Glad that you could make it. I will try to be brief. I didn't actually prepare anything. This is more some thoughts that I've been having for the past few days, you know, based on things that are happening in the world and all of that. Yeah, there seems to be this big separation right now. Everybody pulling to their own side and all of those things. And one trend that I kind of been noticing is that because of the action of some, we are all being judged the same way. And we're being labeled as intolerant and judgmental, and that we are bad people because we're wishing these things on others, which are not true, because we know who God is and what He says. And I think the reason why some people are making certain comments towards others that are actually giving Christians a bad name is because they have a wrong understanding of who God is and what He wants us to do. Amen. And I've been thinking about this scripture, Matthew chapter 22, and it starts in verse 36. It says, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." One thing that I have learned as I've gone through my path as a Christian and a believer in God and His Word is that it is okay for me to have my opinions, but regardless of what my opinion is, I'm not going to judge someone because it goes against an opinion that I have or some value or belief. I'm still going to embrace that person because it says right here, "I shall love my neighbor as I love myself." The Bible also says that you will be judged as you judge others. So who am I to put myself in a position where I'm elevating myself above my fellow man when we're all equal? We're all the same in God's eyes. I'm no better than you. They're no better than me. So I am not someone to be passing judgment because I'm also a flawed individual. And, you know, I'm a sinner. We do things every day that do not go along with what God's teaching is, but He still loves us because even though we're imperfect, we are perfected in Him.
Right.
So it's very important that we come together and know that what God said is the ultimate word. And we don't have to be afraid of things that are happening around us that we think that are going to attempt to either take something from us or make us lesser people and things like that, because we know who we are and what we have, and we have that trust in God. And we come together and we pray for all of these things, knowing that the prayers that we are saying that are going up to our God, He's listening to those and He's moving in every situation.
Yeah.
So we have that comfort and that assurance that although our physical eyes might not be seeing something immediately, we know that God's in that situation and He's moving. And He's taking care of things and moving things according to His plan.
Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing for us to be afraid. Mm-hmm. So let's continue to embrace our neighbor, love them as we love ourselves, regardless of our opinions, because our opinions are of this world. They come from our human mind, not from our spiritual thoughts. So let's keep praying and be reassured that God's moving and there's something for us to be worried about.
Amen.
Amen.
Any prayer requests or testimonies? Yes, Myron.
I was just sharing with Mike and Cindy that kind of what you were just saying. I had a customer the other day, he had about 23, he had green and red hair that stuck straight up and his fingernail black polish on his fingernails, and he was like about 6'1". And when I first picked him up, I thought to myself, all right, what's going on here? You know, I said, all right, Lord. And as I continue in doing that job, I'm seeing that just what you're saying, the Lord is correcting me that, you know, I am no one to judge them. You know, and then him and I, he happened to be from Massachusetts and I grew up in Connecticut. And we knew primarily the same area. This is his first time in Iowa, and it was his first business trip. And I was taking him to the Marriott in Johnson from the airport. And so I'm thinking to myself, really, what business are you in? Because, I mean, here he is with jeans and green hair. Unless he's going to dye his hair overnight or not, I don't know. But, you know, and I just thought, Lord, please forgive me. I mean, he was a nice guy. I've ran into a couple people, other people that, you know, they said, oh, where are you from? And I said, Avon, Connecticut. They said, oh, that's a nice little town. Really? So it's just, you know, just getting to meet people of the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like it says, go out into the world and preach the gospel.
Right.
You know, and it's, they're all coming to me.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it goes. It's awesome.
Amen.
One of the pleasures I have of doing it.
Amen.
Praise God.
And, you know, one of the good things about having opportunities like that is we don't know where that person is in their lives at the moment. And when I drive to Kelly's house, there's a couple of churches on the way, and there's one in particular that always puts some sort of message in there. Front sign, and there was something there this past week that said something about maybe you are the only gospel someone is going to get to know,
mm-hmm.
which is why we want to make sure that we're living our lives following Christ's teachings and be that example. Because that's going to do two things. One is going to remove that misconception that people have that Christians are judgmental and they're bad people and they think they're better than others and things like that, among other opinions that they have. But also, when we allow ourselves to be used by God for Him to move and touch that person, not only that person is going to get blessed, we're going to get blessed as well.
Yeah,
that's right.
And then there's going to be a celebration in heaven because that's one more soul.
Best place you can be is really at the end of your rope. I mean, a lot of people
she had her cell phone, but she had it on speaker, so you could hear the whole conversation. She was waiting in line, and it just struck me, and she was talking about something they was asking to do, and she just said, "Well, I can't do that. I can't do that." And I thought, "Wow, you know, that's not putting much faith in God."
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe we can't do it, but God can.
And I
really believe God doesn't want us to limit Him.
Amen.
You know, and just prove. I mean, so many times I just feel the cry of God's heart, if y'all just would believe me.
Yes.
You know, if my people, you know, God's people,
yeah,
would
yes.
seek His face,
yes,
you know, I mean,
yes.
so much things
yeah,
in
yes.
people's life would turn around.
Right.
You know, when you put God first,
mm-hmm.
you know, then life does change.
I want to thank everybody who prayed today for my sister Katie.
Amen.
The breathing tube was removed this afternoon, and she's got some oxygen assistance, but she's breathing on her own. I'm believing for a completely new set of lungs
yes.
and a new heart.
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise the
Lord. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Go to the Lord tonight. Father, we thank you this evening for bringing us together here to be gathered in your name. Where two or three are gathered in your name, Lord, you are there in the midst of the Lord. We thank you, Father, for moving and releasing your spirit in this place, for giving your word, a word that is used to edify and educate and lift up guide them, Lord, through the revelation of your word you have laid before them. We thank you, Father, for all the things that you do for us, for moving and put it on vibrate. If you don't wanna keep it on. Alright, well, let's speak the word tonight. Will you not revive us again? May your people may rejoice in you. I am a believer,
and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover.
Christ has
redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction of this body in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
sacrifice so freely given, so break every chain. Break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain.
Coming to the fullness and the knowledge of the kingdom of the Lord, that is within us. Thank you.
Lord. If not this generation, what generation? Amen. We just believe that God has called us to a time such as this. Amen. We could have been born in any generation, in any time, but we're here now. And I believe that it's the will of God that He has revealed to this world. A hurting world needs healing. And He is the answer. He is the only answer. Praise God. Give Him a hand clap tonight. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen, amen. God bless you. Please be seated. Thank you, worship team. Great as always. Hallelujah. Appreciate the anointing on this worship team. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Suzanne needed.
And I'll be brief tonight, as brief as possible, and still do what we need to do, but I want to be considerate of your schedules. I know you all, most of you have to be at work tomorrow, and so I'll let you go home and go to bed. God gives us sleep. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. I had a power nap this afternoon for about an hour, so I'm good to go till 10. Amen. God is good. You know, there's a lot of deception in the world, and we need to address it because the enemy is a deceiver, and his one of his main goals is to try to keep us blinded to the goodness of God and the grace of God, the power of God that's available to all of us. Just to give you an idea of deception, I've done a little study on the Miss Universe pageant. It's rigged. That's deception. I mean, it's deception. It's rigged. Because I've done some research and found that every winner was from Earth. Miss Universe pageant. All from Earth. Praise the Lord. Okay, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God's in a good mood, even if y'all are having a little time getting with it here. Praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. So don't bother watching it anymore because it's fixed. Hallelujah. All right, let's go right to Romans chapter 1 and verse 19. Praise the Lord. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. Praise God. So, you know, people will often question the nature of God, the heart of God, in terms of how His heart and His nature is directed to us. And I think God has put eternity in the hearts of all of us. So there's the ability for us to know the love of God and to experience the love of God, but a lot of times we're getting information that is just that. It's not revelation, it's just information that gives us a different picture of God's nature and God's heart. And that comes from the enemy. Obviously, clear back to the garden, he deceived Adam and Eve by making them feel like God wasn't really for them totally, that he was withholding from them and that he was trying to keep them down, so to speak. And that spirit is still in the world today. It's the Antichrist spirit, and it's a spirit of deception. It's a lying spirit that gives us an image of God that is untrue, that is unlike God's true nature and God's true heart. Because, you know, before Adam and Eve gained this knowledge of good and evil, they had an ignorance of good and evil. You say, well, that's, you know, that's not a good thing, is it? Well, it would have been a good thing, because ignorance of good and evil prevented them from doubting that God's love was for them. It wasn't until they knew good and evil that they were afraid of God. Before that, they had no doubt that God loved them, that God cared for them, that God provided for them. They lived a life enjoying unobstructed relationship with God without any guilt, without any shame. Can you say praise the Lord? How many people would be better today psychologically, emotionally, physically, if there was no guilt and no shame? Amen. That's what God has come to set us free from. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And that's not talking about being perfect. That just means staying connected with God rather than the flesh, rather than the natural man. Amen. So in their eyes and God's, they were acceptable until they fell. Adam and Eve knew they were God's beloved until they learned the knowledge of good and evil. Praise the Lord. So now, even today, regardless of God's attempts to show his love to us, human beings are driven by doubt, by fear, by anxiety, because we know that our thoughts and our desires and our behavior fall short of perfection. And if you don't know that, it won't take long for somebody to remind you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. After the fall, we became the referees of our own morality. We became the ones who made the call. It's kind of like in the book of, at the end of the book of Judges. I remember preaching years ago a message. The very next book is the book of Ruth. And it talks about the last verse or two in the book of Judges says, and the people did that which was right in their own eyes. And the very next verse is the first verse in the book of Ruth says, and there was a famine in the land. Not for lack of bread. I mean, there was a famine for bread, but the metaphor there was really the bread of life, because they didn't know God, because they didn't have that relationship with God. And so from the fall on, man has been pretty much the guy who decides morality, what's good and what's evil. That's why we see the chaos that we see in the world. The scripture clearly shows God's intention for us is to live an abundant life.
Yes.
Amen. Abundant life. You can't have an abundant life if you are depressed. You can't have an abundant life if you're insecure, if you're afraid, if you're ashamed, if you're feeling guilty. Amen. Mm-hmm. This abundant life, actually, it describes the quality of life that God has.
Come on.
Amen. And we are heirs of God.
Yes.
God wants us to enjoy life the way God sees it, the way God experiences it. How many of you know God's not afraid? Amen. There's no anxiety going on in heaven. He's not fearful. He's not worried about tomorrow. He knows the end from the beginning. Amen. He wants us to have that kind of a life. He wants us to experience that kind of a life. Look, let's go to Isaiah, Roberto. Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9. My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. Water is supposed to help that, but so my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Now that's speaking of someone who hasn't had their mind renewed to the Word of God. Because the purpose, excuse me, of having your mind renewed to the Word of God is so that you can think like God. So that we're not any longer, see, the carnal mind is enmity with God. It's at cross purposes with God. But the spirit mind, or the mind of the Spirit, is one with God. That's why the Spirit can, you know, we have in the services, and it happens all the time, God will speak to somebody, they'll give a testimony, and it speaks directly to somebody else's situation. Well, the testimonies will deal directly with what God has already given me to speak on. Or after the service, you'll talk to somebody, and they'll give you thought, provoking words that quicken something of the Spirit in you. And you know, this is the Lord. This is God. Amen? So that's where we want to be. We want to be where God can use us, where God's Spirit can work through us and flow through us. Now, that doesn't take, surprisingly, it doesn't take a lot of effort on our part. It really demands that we rest in God, that we relax and quit trying to overthink things and just let God be the director of the play. Amen? All the world is a stage, you know, Shakespeare said. Well, in some sense it is. But God is the great director and the producer, and he knows the whole play. Amen? He's got the dialogue for everybody. Praise the Lord. All we got to do is just follow the script. Amen? This right here. Just trust the Lord. And he'll put you in situations, just like what Myron was talking about, and Roberto and others this evening, where God can speak to them, where God can minister to them. And a lot of times it's not necessarily scripture, you know, in terms of chapter and verse, but it's principle. It's the principles here, because a lot of times when you're talking to sinners and unbelievers, Bible verses don't mean anything to them anyway because they don't know the Bible. But the principles are still real and true, and they will connect with those. Those are realities. Those are the identity of God, in a sense. So if we'll think with God, if we'll stay in tune with God in the Spirit, there's no limit to what God can do in us and through us. Because we experience true freedom only when we are able to shake off the religious cliches and legalistic demands, and we get back to genuine understanding of God before the fall, because that's the God that we're dealing with.
Yes, yes, yes.
I love what Suzanne was saying, and the Spirit, you know, the truth will set you free.
That's right.
Yes. And Jesus said, I am the truth,
Woo-hoo.
The way, and the life.
Yeah.
Amen? And the only way we can really know God honestly and genuinely and be able to share him, you know, truly with somebody else is to get back to the God before the fall, because we have been redeemed, praise the Lord, and we didn't get redeemed to a better law, we got redeemed to innocence, we got redeemed back to the garden, praise the Lord. So, hallelujah. Fortunately for us, there's a new garden.
Yes.
Amen. And he talks about it in Hebrews, if you will, Hebrews chapter 4, verse 10. This is what the world needs to know. Sadly, this is what the church needs to know, because unless we know it, the world's never going to know it either. Praise the Lord. He that has entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his own works as God did from his. God's rest. And that's a place that once we enter this garden, we're able to find the good God that everybody's really looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Not a made-up God. Not a religion,
yeah.
But the good God,
amen.
That started this whole thing and will wrap it all up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I've got some thoughts, some things that I'm working on for Sunday. And it really is, the enemy's job is to steal our territory. Now that doesn't just mean kingdom territory, where we go and what we do, but the very rest of God, the garden. He's still after the garden. Praise the Lord. And I think, sadly, a lot of times church people or Christians don't recognize that we've been put back in the garden. But it's a garden of rest. And without rest, we're constantly going back to the tree and eating the knowledge of good and evil over and over again. It doesn't make us unsaved. It just makes us disconnect all the time from what God is really trying to do in us and through us. It creates chaos. It creates confusion. It creates fear. It creates stress. It creates anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
It creates weak, anemic Christians.
Right.
Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 24 and verse 5. We're afraid to be free. We're not unlike the Israelites. When they got set free from slavery, it wasn't long before they were thinking, you know, slavery wasn't that bad. At least we had onions and garlic and spicy stuff to eat, and, you know. I don't know why, but human nature is, even though we're always saying we want to be free, I mean, we live in a country where this is the thing, you know, but the truth is, we're always looking for some security, a security net, which always ends up, you know, the old saying, you give somebody power, they're going to take it.
Yeah.
Power corrupts, and absolute power absolutely corrupts. You give somebody authority over your life, pretty soon they're going to be taking charge of your life. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
God wants to be in charge. He doesn't want us relinquishing it to anybody or anything. Amen? Not even for our sense of security. Yeah, it may be a little, you know, frightening at first to step out in faith. But once you do it, there's a liberty in that, you know, that just can't be matched. And the only way we can do that is to know that if I fall, He's there to pick me up. If I deviate from the path, the Holy Spirit can move me back. If I screw it up, if I intentionally do something, He's still going to love me. He's still going to embrace me. He's still going to keep me, amen, in His love, in His inheritance,
yes.
Amen, because we're not getting thrown out of the garden again.
Come on.
We got to leave on our own. That's the only way you can separate yourself, is to walk away. And that's why He's constantly reaffirming His love to us. His goodness, His mercy, His faithfulness, so over and over and over. So at some point, we'll finally get secure in this relationship to where we know He's not loving me because of how good I am or how good I look or what I'm doing or not doing. He just loves me because He can't help Himself.
Come on.
He loves us.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He is love.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. For many shall come in My name saying, I am Christ. And shall deceive many. And that is exactly what's happened.
Right.
We can worry about Islam. We can worry about New Age. We can worry about, you know, the financial conditions of the world and all the rest of it. But the real enemy is Jesus being represented as a religion.
Yep.
Or a type of antichrist.
Yep.
Amen? Who appears in form and principle to be Jesus, but whose character is altogether different than Jesus. And I got to tell you, you can go to churches all over. Now, I'm not picking on churches. I'm just saying you can go to any place all over and hear Jesus being preached, and you wonder, who is this?
Right.
I mean, from our perspective, I'm thinking, wait a minute. He sounds awfully angry. He sounds really mad. He sounds really judgmental and critical, and I don't see that in the Scripture. And let me remind you, Jesus is simply God in the flesh.
Yep.
He is that God of the garden.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Remember that old Joni Mitchell? I think it was Joni Mitchell. We got to get back to the garden. Man, I'm telling you, we got to get back to the garden, because there's a world out there that is doing everything by the sweat of their own brow, and a lot of that world is church.
Right.
Work, 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 amen. Trying, amen, to gain God's approval when God has already given His approval through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Our faith in that, amen, creates a new creature.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. The second Adam, as Suzanne spoke of. Amen. The Adam that will never fail. The Adam that will never fall. The Adam that will always be embraced by God.
Yes.
And protected and provided for. In the garden, all Adam had to do was pick the fruit. His only job was to take what he needed. That's where God wants. That's the place of rest, where God, once again, is the provider, where He's our healer. He's our deliverer. He gives us dominion again over everything, amen, in the earth, except one another.
Yes.
Praise God. During the ministry of Jesus here on earth, the real Jesus, who was and is God in the flesh, He's attractive. Not by His physical appearance. We don't really know what He looked like, but He probably looked like the average Jewish male at that time. He was attractive by His Spirit. And that Spirit is the Spirit of love. And He's filled with the Spirit of love and peace. We were talking after church Sunday. It got me thinking about some of these things. But, you know, the Holy Ghost, we think the Holy Ghost is like, he's kind of God's monitor. hall monitor, if you will. He's waiting to catch you screwing up, and then he's going to fix it. That's not the Holy Spirit. It's the love of God. It's the spirit of love that God has placed in each one of us. So that we can know God. So that God can be revealed. The religious people are offended by him. But other people, like us, we're just filled with wonder. It's just awesome to us. We just can't get enough. Because he's so good. But, it's true of modern Christianity that they still say that all you need is Jesus. And they accept Christ-centered theology. Both experientially and relationally, our consciousnesses are flooded with a list of New Testament rules and expectations that we've been told we have to follow in order to maintain God's love and hang on to our salvation. I'm going to just say something that may shock you, and I hope it doesn't offend you, but that's Antichrist. Yeah. That's the spirit of Antichrist.
Right.
I'm not saying these are demons doing this. I'm just saying that spirit was in the world when the first century disciples and apostles were here.
Right.
Paul said it himself. It's Antichrist and so on and so forth, and he said that spirit of Antichrist is here already. And how did he know that? Because he was constantly being confronted with this religious group within Christianity that were trying to add something to grace and something to the goodness of God to mix, the old wine and new wineskins and demean or diminish the love of God, which is the very power of God. I mean, I'm just touching the surface of this a little bit, but when Jesus said the only command there is under this new covenant is the law of love,
right.
Law of faith, but he talks about the commandment to love one another. Mm-hmm. It's what Roberto was talking about earlier, because that is where power is released. Paul said, look, if I speak with the tongues of men or angels and I do this miracle, perceive miracles, he said, and yet I don't love. I'm a tinkling bell. I'm just a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. I'm just a noise. Praise the Lord. Because the real power of God flows through the love of God. We wonder why Jesus was so consistently miraculous. When, in fact, we are told we are the same as he in this world. We have that same ability. The fullness of God dwelt in him, and then the scripture goes on to say, and of that fullness have all we received. Jesus even said himself, you'll greater miracles than these shall you do. But why don't we? I think because we're trying to perform so much based on our goodness, our effort, our energy, our concentrated focus, when if we could learn to love. See, it's hard to love when you're not sure you're loved. Mm-hmm. You'll do lots of things that you call love, but it's really not love. It's other stuff. It's pretend. It's try to do something to guarantee the love of somebody else. And God's whole purpose in coming to this earth, and not only to save us from sin, but to get us to know this love. This love is the power of the universe. It's the thing that changes everything.
Yes.
For God so loved
yes.
the world. And if the church can ever get, I mean, it's not something you can just grasp intellectually. That's why it's difficult to even explain. And I don't know all the answers to this. I'm just saying, again, I was provoked by the conversation that we had Sunday, and it made me stop and think. And the more I look at Scripture, the more I realize the channel or the avenue through which God flows, it's always love.
Mm-hmm.
It always is. And so a lot of times we're doing miracles for the sake of miracles.
Mm-hmm.
Not because we love, but because we just think it's what we do.
Come on.
Amen. I think if we get to the place where we can really obey that one command and receive love, then love will flow
yes.
like a river.
Amen.
And when we have that kind of love, people can be healed without a prayer, without a touch, by simply being in their presence the way it was for the apostles. When their shadow would just go by them and people would be healed. That's the will of God. That's what God wants for his church. That's what God has always wanted. And that's what he wants to this day. And I believe it's going to happen. I believe it has to happen, amen, before the return of the Lord. I just want it to be this generation. Amen. I want to be a part of this. I want to experience this. And I'm not comfortable with the love stuff. You know what I'm saying? Joyce Meyer make me nervous when she gets into the lovey-dovey. I can't help it. I got to get over it. And I'm not just talking about smarmy, you know, kind of words. I'm talking about just love from the heart. Just allow God's love to flow. We hear it here in every service. Amen. Every time we have a prayer request, you know that the heart of God is speaking through that individual because there's a love, there's a compassion there. And we need to get back to the garden. We need to get back to that where that is a natural flow, a natural result of just our being. And that's what God is after. Praise the Lord. There's nothing more that we have to do for God's love. He's poured it out. He loves us unconditionally, constantly. Praise the Lord. John, let's look at this. John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. Let's see if I can do this again. Just for the fun of it. That's better. That last one was kind of like tequila. Not that I know what tequila tastes like. I'm just assuming. It must be pretty strong. Man, I'm just having a problem with it. We say Roberto? No, he's not paying attention. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Now, here's what has happened. The church has made, a lot of times, has made the mistake that in this area of Jesus' word teaching, you know, concerning this particular scripture, and they invent a Jesus who is a deliverer of a new and improved list of obligations and rules from God. They take that scripture and try to make it sound as if, okay, it's God, the Ten Commandment God, and there he is, and yeah, okay, we're not going to have the Ten Commandments, but we'll have some others. And so if you follow my word, you know, that's basically where they get this, and then they try to twist this all into a whole list of things. And so what happens is we've traded the Old Testament laws and regulations for New Testament principles and priorities. It's the same game, it's just a different name.
Mm-hmm. Come on.
And I know, again, some people are uncomfortable with that because they think, well then, you know, here we go. Just no holds barred, people will be just doing anything and everything. Let me tell you something. Most of them are doing anything and everything anyhow. Right?
Yep.
And so the more rules and regulations haven't worked any more now than they did initially because they were never meant to work to bring sin to an end. They were to bring us to an end.
Yes.
So that we would trust in God and his grace to transform us. Praise the Lord. John 8, verse 31. John said to Jesus, or then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Who he is what he's saying.
Yeah.
He is the word, right? If you continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Mm-hmm. Who he is, what he came to do, then you're disciples. You can't be a disciple if you're following a different Jesus than the Jesus that was here.
Right.
You're something else. I don't know what you are, but you're not a disciple of Jesus. Because when you understand who he is, the God of the garden, amen, has shown up to take us back to the garden, to the place of rest, to where God's in charge, where God takes care of everything, where God provides, then the truth will set you free.
Right.
That truth will set you free.
Come on.
Freedom comes from the teaching about Jesus and his goodness.
Yes.
His grace, his love, his acceptance, his sacrifice, his payment.
Mm-hmm.
Hebrews 7:12. Now, Roberto read most of this last week, or last Sunday, I should say, when he was doing the prelims and giving us some insights into some things that God was showing him. And I was thinking about it during the time you were talking. I thought, you know, man, that is so right. And I think a lot of times, you know, we read stuff and we read it because we're used to reading it. It's in the Bible, and we don't see the context in which God is trying to reveal it to us. And that can change.
Right.
But for the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. So in other words, just to paraphrase what he already said, when the priesthood is changed, the law's got to change too.
Yep.
It has to. That's just the way it is, right? Okay, verses 18 and 19. Jesus is the high priest. He is now the high priest.
Yes.
Amen? So, for there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did,
yes,
by the which we draw nigh to God. So there has to be an end or a disannulling of the commandment going before,
right,
and because it was weakness, it was unprofitable.
Mm-hmm.
It couldn't save you.
Right.
It condemned you.
Right.
That's all it could do.
Mm-hmm.
And so it had to come to an end, and when it did, and he tells us immediately in verse 19, because the law made nothing perfect.
Right.
It just showed all the flaws.
Right.
Amen? But the bringing in of a better hope did.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
It did what the law couldn't do.
Right.
Amen? By the which now we draw nigh to God.
Yes.
It's by the new covenant that we're able to come close to God. We're able to come back into relationship, amen, with God. The former regulation is set aside because it's weak. And it's useless,
right,
because the law made nothing perfect.
Right.
And a better hope is introduced by which we now can draw near to God.
Yes.
We can come boldly to the throne of grace.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Verse 22. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament or a better covenant.
Yes. Yes.
The old system that was dependent on us, based on our performance, our keeping the rules, has been changed for a new system.
Yes.
And it's based completely on Christ's performance.
Yes.
This is so simple, but yet, I mean, you got to work to complicate it.
Yeah.
I mean, if you just read it for what it says, it's obvious.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Verses 24 and 25. But this man, Jesus, because he continueth forever, has an unchangeable priesthood.
Right.
He's the same yesterday, forever. He's eternal. He's never going to change. He'll always be the high priest. So there's never going to be another one. There's not going to be another law or another testament or another covenant. This is the covenant. Amen. Wherefore, he is able also, because this is never going to change, he's able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto him by God, or
yes,
come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Now, I mean, it's easy to get the impression that every time we screw up, Jesus is running over to the Father and saying, you know, give him a break. You know, I love him and he's not that bad a guy. No, his very presence is a constant interceding on our behalf. He doesn't have to say a word. God looks and sees Jesus. He says Nathan, but he sees Jesus. Amen? He's there constantly representing me as the righteousness of God in him.
Yes. Yes.
That's all God sees. If you don't believe that, look, I mean, read Hebrews 11 sometime. When you see all these people who are just screw-ups. But there's no evidence. There's no testimony. There's nothing there but their great faith. The liars, the laughers, the mockers, the ridiculers, the cheaters, all of this, and yet the only record in heaven, which is what's recorded in Hebrews 11, is how great these people were. They believed God. And God called them righteous. Our record is settled. It's in Christ. It's perfection. It's perfect. Praise God. This new one is all based on Jesus, his performance. His priesthood is eternal. Amen. His nature, his gift of righteousness, and his faithfulness is what it's based on. Now, if that doesn't give you liberty, if that doesn't give you freedom, you don't know what freedom is. Amen. That's what he's talking about. If you follow my words, then are you my disciples, and you'll know the truth, and that truth will set you free.
Yes, Lord.
Free indeed.
Yes.
No more laying awake at night worrying about, I wish I hadn't said that. I'm not saying we want to live like heathens. I'm saying you'll be more likely to do good accidentally than you ever could intentionally. Because you're not worried, you're not thinking about it, you're not concentrating on it all that. You're just thinking about the love of God and God's love for you, and you can go and be used of God in any situation, in any circumstance, at any time. I mean, I've had God do things in my life when I had made the biggest mistakes, the biggest screw-ups, the poorest choices, and yet God poured out a blessing and did things in me and through me that I just thought, there's got to be a mistake. He's got me mixed up with somebody. Because I still had this lingering belief that something had to be based on what I did and didn't do in order for God to really love me and want to use me. And that is just bogus. It's just not true. It defies the whole new covenant to believe anything other than what we're talking about here tonight. That's the teaching that sets us free. God's original intent was to meet with everybody, to be with everybody. Let's go look at this in Exodus chapter 19, verses 10 and 11. My wife believes it. She just can only listen to me for so long. You know, after 37 years. It is. Exodus 19, verses 10 and 11. The Lord said unto Moses, go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes and be ready against the third day. For the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of the people on Mount Zion. Now, hold it there for just a minute. Let's look at this kind of metaphorically. The Lord said to Moses, go to the people, sanctify them. Wash their clothes. Now, what did Jesus do? We are sanctified because of Christ. He has washed us. He has cleansed us from all unrighteousness, right? He has washed away our filth and our uncleanness and our sin, right? And the third day, he said, be ready the third day. What happened on the third day? The Lord rose up, amen, and we had access, right? And for the third day, the Lord will come down in the sight of the people on Mount Zion, or on Mount Sinai. So Jesus, it's like a look forward. God is saying, you know, this is happening now, but I want you to think about this.
Yes.
It's going to happen. For real. But here's the other side of this same coin. See, despite God's intention and God's desires to be near with the people, those things weren't fulfilled. They didn't come to pass because the Israelites were afraid of God. And the result was the people stayed at a distance. And I'm telling you, we're seeing the same thing today. Jesus has come near. The third day, he's risen. He's in us. And people are still afraid. They're still scared of him. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 4 and 5. We'll close with this. The Lord talked with you face to face in the mount of the midst of the fire. And this is Moses speaking. I stood between the Lord and you at that time to show you the word of the Lord, for you were afraid by reason of the fire and went not up into the mountain. Jesus stands between the justice, the truth, the holiness of God, and our flesh. But we don't go up because we're afraid. Am I making sense? Praise the Lord.
Yes.
You know, humans are humans.
Yep.
And for some reason, we can't get it through our head that God just loves us and wants to be with us.
Yes.
He wants to walk with us in the cool of the afternoon.
Yes.
He wants to provide for us. He wants us out of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and just live by the tree of life.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
We keep running back to the tree for more fruit. It's just poison that keeps us fearful of God.
Yes.
Instead of just embracing His goodness and His grace.
Yes.
And His provision.
Amen.
The sooner we do that, church, the sooner we'll see the power of God.
Yes.
Manifest in us and through us. It won't have to be sporadic. It won't have to be inconsistent. It won't have to be based on us anymore. It'll be based solely on His will. And we know what His will is because we saw Jesus fulfilling His will for 3.5 years when all He did was go about doing good. All He did
yes.
was go about healing all those that came to Him
yes.
and believed. Deliverance, setting captives free,
yes.
open the blinded eyes. That's the will of God. It always has been. It always will be.
Yes.
Let's get back to the garden. Let's get into that territory of rest
yes.
and stay there. So that God can be revealed. So that God can be seen as He really is, as He truly is. A God who loves us and gave Himself for us.
Yes.
Can you say amen?
Amen?
Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. It's all good. It is all good in Jesus. That's all you got to know. Amen. It's all good. Not only is it all good in Jesus, but it's all good between you. God bless you. You're all dismissed in Jesus' name. Hope to see you back here Sunday. Have a great rest of your week.